Good late afternoon to everyone. Maybe we are a little bit behind the schedule, so I will make a very simple proposal and very brief one. Well, the title is Optimizing In-Situ Testing for Historic Masonry Structures, and this main topic will be a little bit combined with a similar proposal for investigations of, let's say, iron or historic steel structures. The proposal was made together with Jana Marková from CTU in Prague and together with Dimitris from OTH Regensburg. And I will just go to the topic immediately. Well, the motivation is that for masonry construction there is a long history all around Europe, and we can observe quite considerable scatter of properties depending on age of the structure, region specific constituent to make bricks and mortar, different manufacturing processes. So it's widely recognized that it's really crucial to obtain case specific information when we are assessing historic masonry structures. For heritage structures, it was just discussed in after previous contribution. We have to consider also the heritage value or cultural heritage value, and that's why non or minor destructive testing procedures are commonly applied with very limited number of destructive testing. To make the proposal, let's say, very simple, so we are trying to make focus only on spot monitoring, so one point in time. Maybe this could be sufficient to show the main principles of value of information analysis. And just to make motivation complete, ISO standard on assessment of existing structures, which includes annex on heritage structures, indicates that in some cases destructive tests may be necessary to calibrate non-destructive techniques. This is a little bit in conflict with current practice, because I'm coming from Klockner Institute, which is a testing laboratory, and our director would not sign any expert assessment which is based only on non-destructive testing. So there is a need for optimization, and I think it's relatively clear. So more specifically, what is the proposal? We compiled a database of 14 historic stone and brick masonry structures which are spanning the periods from 17th century to 20th century. And we hope that a unique feature of the database is that for each of these structures we have a direct comparison of destructive tests and of two non-destructive techniques, Schmidt rebound hammer and modified drill test, which is the technique which was developed specifically for heritage masonry structures. So we have some database to compare destructive and non-destructive tests. To have maybe a bit better insight into data, on these two graphs we have comparison for the two non-destructive test techniques. On horizontal axis we have destructive tests always, and on vertical axis there is uncertainty in non-destructive technique. The definition here accepted is that let's say modal uncertainty or test uncertainty is defined as a ratio of destructive tests over non-destructive test results. So if we are above one, we have a conservative estimate from non-destructive technique. If we are below one, we are unsafe. So from these graphs we immediately see that the non-destructive techniques are not really well calibrated with respect to the effect of magnitude of compressive strength of the tested brick or stone. And yeah, this is just the database we have. We can accept two approaches. Maybe based on this limited database, we can recalibrate the non-destructive technique. This is obvious. Or we can also follow the following approach, which is taken now in practice. So for each structure, require some validation of non-destructive testing by destructive tests. So for instance, if we apply three destructive tests on basis of which we calibrate a non-destructive technique, we of course remove nearly perfectly the bias. All these data are just taken from the real cases, so there is no simulation, nothing, just the cases in the database up to now, and we see that the bias is more or less removed. But we still have some scatter in test uncertainty, which can be expressed by terms of coefficient of variation of about 20%. So this is just what we have in the database and what is open for further treatment within the cost action. We have a similar database for mortar. This is just the database by which the non-destructive test technique was calibrated. Well, what are the challenges or what are open questions we see? So, well, of course, it would be very useful for engineering practice to indicate what is appropriate method for survey. So we would like to balance between related costs, uncertainty in outcomes, required precision, and of course, at the end, we have to do something with failure consequences, which is a little bit difficult for heritage structures, but we can perhaps accept some simplifications. So for total cost optimization, we can consider costs of non-destructive tests and costs of destructive testing. Well, the tricky part is also that the destructive tests may affect a cultural heritage value, but we hope that in some reasonable simplification we can overcome this. At the end, we end up probably with reliability index, which will be a function of number of non-destructive and number of destructive tests, and well, we can optimize on the basis of this. There is another open question, consideration of upgrade costs, because this is also the part of the game, not only to get detailed insight on actual reliability of the structure, but on possible intervention, and again we can affect cultural heritage value. At the end, and we saw it in the first keynote lecture today, our decisions will very likely depend also decisions related to monitoring system or spot monitoring system will depend on how real reliability index is closed to the target level. So how safe is our structure, which is the issue for heritage structures, because they are quite frequently, let's say, they were designed in a conservative way. So another set of open questions, calibration of NDT non-destructive techniques by using the limited database. This is just a practical question whether to do this or not. Number of tests for components of different areas, so consideration of spatial variability, degradation effects, all these can play a role in a proposed monitoring system or in an optimized number of tests. And the third open question is we should be able to prove that a non-destructive technique is able to identify material non-homogeneity, because for masonry structures this is for historic structures this is a crucial issue. So we can, for instance, rely on three destructive tests, but provided the situation that we are able to identify different material in a structure by non-destructive technique. And then just a practical question is, should we make a distinction between preliminary and detailed assessment? Probably we should. And quantification of related uncertainties for practical applications. So also we would like to give some support for future similar studies. So, well, synergy with other case studies, we hope that this will be discussed in a few minutes. And I already announced that we have just a similar motivation, similar database for historic metal structures. So if I can spend just 3 slides or 3 minutes with these. So basically for historic steel structures, if this proposal is also found interesting for the action, we have a similar but much smaller database. So on horizontal axis in this graph we have a destructive test result and tensile strength of a material. We have test uncertainty again on vertical axis, and here we have a comparison of 3 non-destructive test hardness methods, basically Brinell, Lab and Poldi Hammer. So we have 3 different techniques here in the graph, and similar open questions as for masonry. For historic metal structures, the situation is a little bit better because this material is basically more homogeneous and maybe let's say a little bit reduced database can be still used to have some reasonable results. Just from the comparison, we see that the methods under consideration are again more or less unbiased with some variability. So these are non-validated by any destructive testing, and we see that coefficient of variation of testing uncertainty is not so large, but we are inspecting materials which often has a lower coefficient of variation for tensile strength, for instance. So open question, effect of material type. We have different historic metal materials, so can we prove that it has effect on testing uncertainty? Number of tests for large structures, this could be an issue. Again, can we prove that non-destructive technique is able to identify material non-homogeneity? Should we make distinction between preliminary and detailed assessment? And again, just to support practical applications, we hope to quantify related uncertainties and give guidance if you do a verification or validation by, say, 3 tensile tests, you reduce the uncertainty in measurement by some range. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Those direct reliability levels are derived from the pre-posterior decision analysis, which we are implementing when we are doing a value of information analysis. If we work only reliability-based, then we have the target reliability, the design and the assessment. But when we work risk and expected benefit, expected cost, utility-based, yeah. Then we don't necessarily need
to fix. Yeah, yeah. This is a good comment. Yeah.
Also common to derivatives.
At the end.
Target reliability is once we do an optimization, lose
That's a boundary condition. Yeah. You can implement it more or less also like we said before in Matteo's presentation. But when we accept that the target variability should be coming from an optimization.
You're right, Dimitri, that we have target reliabilities in regulations, but they are coming from.
They should come.
Should come from optimization. And in the case of new codes, it is the case that they are coming from.
In some particular situation, this is a historical structure, so for heritage structures, it is an annex, as he said. And the other stadium, it is a temporary situation, so I think in both cases, economic decision criteria could be implemented to illustrate the value of information directly.
But the target reliability is a longer story. I think it's really critical.
How it will be implemented in guidelines with account for practice, this is another question, but for matters of illustration first, at that stage, it is okay to include.
We'll see.
Well, we'll see.
We'll discuss. We have much more.
It's not easy.
But let's go on.
The manifestation of what Matteo was talking about, two different metrics for cost, right? One is reliability driven, the other one is risk driven, really. Right? They are not the same.
Yeah, but in a risk analysis,
we are talking now in your previous presentation.
So we will have some occasions to discuss this further. It's a very interesting topic. So thank you.